The Eightfold Path is very important to understand. Now, everybody thinking about the Eightfold Path has learned that it's right this and right that. And I don't like that definition, because if there's right, then there's wrong. And that means everything is either black or white. And I'm sorry, we don't live in a black and white world. We live in a colored world. And there are shades of everything. So instead of right, I use the word harmonious. And I change all the other words too. Instead of right view or right understanding, I call it harmonious perspective. What is harmonious perspective? The harmonious perspective is seeing everything as being part of an impersonal process. Not taking anything personally. The last time I was here, I talked about I helped a man building his house, and all of a sudden, and I was doing it for free. I just did it because I wanted to help him. And all of a sudden, he started thinking he was my boss. Started pushing me around. And that did not go over well with me, let's put it that way. And I got really angry at him, and he said something that really got me mad. And I started walking away, and for some reason I got this thought that this clown thinks he's my boss. And it made me laugh. And as soon as I laughed, I was shocked at what happened into my mind. I went from, I'm mad and I think I ought to punch this guy in the nose, to, it's only this anger. It went from being very personal to being impersonal. And that's when I started recognizing the importance of laughter. But not laughing at things, laughing with yourself for getting caught. The more you can laugh with yourself, it changes your perspective from I am that, and I don't like it particularly, to it's only that. Shh, what's that? Easy to let go of. So having a harmonious perspective means seeing things the way they truly are, as being part of an impersonal process. The next part of the Eightfold Path, is they generally call it right thought, and that's horrible translation. I call it harmonious imaging. What kind of an image do you hold in your mind? I'm always sick. That's the kind of image you hold. That's what your mind produces because you hold that image. I'm always happy. That's what your mind will produce for you. What kind of image do you hold in your mind? I'm always broke. Yeah, okay. That's the way you want to be. That you can do that. But are you being in harmony? And again, this is still working with the idea of the self or no self. What kind of an image do you pull up? When you're practicing loving-kindness meditation, you pull up an image of kindness and love towards someone else and surround them with that image. And it's real fun doing that kind of meditation because they do feel it. So, depending on the kind of image, I have one student that continually holds the image in their mind that they can't remember things. And they reinforce that by saying it over and over and over again. As a result, I teased her about living in the hereafter. When you get to be a certain age, you live in the hereafter. You walk into the room and you shake your, you scratch your head and say, "What did I come here after?" The next part of the Eightfold Path, the next three parts of the Eightfold Path, when you read in the suttas, they basically just shuck it off and say, this is only morality. You don't have to pay attention to that when you're meditating, because you're already moral by meditating. Well, this is an age-old argument that happens with the monks. The practicing monks say, no, you can't take these out. You can't take these three parts out and say it's only morality, then you don't have to pay attention to them, because that's not an eightfold path, that's a fivefold path. And that's the way the scholars look at it. But the way meditators look at it is, this is an eightfold path, and every different aspect of the eightfold path has to do with your meditation. What is harmonious communication, right? Speech. Your harmonious communication is not only when you're talking to other people, but when you're talking to yourself. As you be more kind to yourself, then you start noticing your kindness comes out through your speech to other people. I'm continually telling people to stop being so hard on themselves. I'm continually reminding people, hey, you're one of the good guys. Why are you doing that to yourself? I had an aunt die just a couple of weeks ago. And my other aunt had spent almost her whole life taking care of this aunt that died. She'd go out of her way, take her, do this, do that, always being helpful to her. She happened to not be there when the aunt died. And she started feeling guilty. I should have been there. I had a long talk with her about that. I said, who are you kidding? What are you feeling guilty about? Because you weren't there when she died? Was this written in stone that you have to be with somebody when they die? What is this? You have no right to feel guilty at all. As much as you did for her, as much as you loved her and helped her, you have to stop criticizing yourself because your life didn't meet her expectation. Things didn't happen the way you would have liked them to happen. Welcome to real life. That's the way it is. You can't criticize yourself and beat yourself up because you don't meet your own expectations. You have to practice being kind to yourself. Now the next part of the Eightfold Path is called right action. And I call it harmonious movement. Now, right action is the part of the precepts, not killing, not stealing, not having, not telling lies, and that sort of thing. Not having wrong sexual activity. That's part of right action, but it's more clearly defined as harmonious movement because you want to stop jerking your mind around in your meditation. You want to move in harmony with learning how to let go. If you put too much energy into letting something go, you're causing yourself more stress and more problems. You have to learn that balance, and that's what the harmonious movement is about. It's about staying in balance with what's happening in the present moment. And you can't judge this present moment with what happened in the last present moment. You have to be able to be in harmony with the movement. Sometimes it takes more energy to do things than it does other. You have to learn that balance. Now, the next part of the Eightfold Path has always been kind of comical for me because they call it right livelihood. And their definition in the suttas of right livelihood is not selling any firearms, not selling any poisons, taking any slaves and selling them. Slavery is real big in this world, whether you know it or not. Now, what does that have to do with meditation? Your harmonious lifestyle has to do with what you put in front of your mind and how you live with that. That lady came and told me she was having horrible dreams. Absolutely terrible dreams. I said, why? She said, I don't know. Maybe it's because I went to this horror fit last night. And I said, okay, don't do that anymore. But I like those kinds of dreams. Well, don't come to me and complain about bad dreams then. The next part of the Eightfold Path is called right effort. And I call this harmonious practice. Right harmonious practice is recognizing when you have an unwholesome state. Letting go of that unwholesome state and relaxing. Smiling. Bringing up that wholesome state. Now, what's a wholesome state when you're meditating? Your object of meditation. Along with smiling. Repeating. Keeping that wholesome state going. Practice this all the time. All the time. 6 hours work, whether you're going to the laundromat, or you're in the store, or you're at your work. 6 hours work all the time. It's just remembering to use it. And that's one of the reasons that you need time by yourself sitting in meditation, because you're learning how to develop that habit. So you can take that with you with your other day. The next part of the Eightfold Path is called right mindfulness. I call it harmonious observation. Mindfulness is remembering to observe how one's attention moves. It's very close to the enlightenment factor of investigation. It's very close to it. It's not yet exact. The more you can remember to observe and let go of the cravings and the nonsense stuff that goes in our minds. You walk from here to your car, what are you thinking about? observe that, let it be, relax, and pull up a wholesome object. There's a lot of things that you do during the day that you do kind of in a dream world or in a sleep world. You just kind of do it, but you're not really there. And you notice that you're doing that. Practice, the harmonious practice is what you need so that your mindfulness gets sharper. You can see it more clearly. The last part of the Eightfold Path is called right concentration, and concentration is not a word that I like to use. Because in this country, concentration means focusing on one thing very deeply. You see athletes and baseball players, they'll be up at bat and they'll say, "Oh, look at that concentration. His eyes aren't blinking, he's really focused in on what's happening in the present moment. He's not seeing the tension that's caused." So that's not the right kind of concentration. Anything that does not have that relaxed step in it is wrong concentration. It's not harmonious collectiveness. And a harmonious collectiveness includes all of the jhanas. So, I just gave you the Eightfold Path. And how to use the Eightfold Path with your meditation. When you smile, you're practicing the entire Eightfold Path at that time. When you let go of the tension and tightness in your head, you're practicing the Eightfold Path at that time. They're all interconnected, they're interwoven. They support each other very much. So this is kind of an interesting thing, because so many people have this idea that the Eightfold Path is just part of a philosophy that doesn't have anything really to do with your practice. And it has a lot to do with your practice. This is the way of the practice. Everything the Buddha taught was always pointed at having a happy, uplifted mind that was content. So, as we practice letting go of the craving, we will naturally develop that. As you practice smiling into things, you will naturally develop this. Make the meditation a fun game to play. The more fun you have practicing it, the more you want to practice it because it's fun. And that helps your interest stay high. And when you have good interest and you're having fun doing something, you learn it fast.